What's up, Backgammon fans? This is Marc Olsen from backgammongalaxy.com. Today I'm gonna make a video with regards to backgammon literature. My favorite and least favorite backgammon books. I'm gonna rate the books. Of course, it's a subjective, it's my opinion. It's not the full truth. It's just how I feel about these books. I'm gonna give them two different ratings. I'm gonna rate the books with regards to their current content, that is evaluated how I feel the content is compared to 2019 and the knowledge that players have nowadays. And then I'm gonna rate them as well with regards to their historical significance and how good this book were when they wrote the book. Maybe it's a book from another era. So that's what I'm gonna do today. So let's get started. First of all, I want to start with Paul McGrill, Backgammon. Probably the most famous backgammon book of all time. The most iconic, the most significant, the most impressive, written in, I think it's written in 1976. You can see I even have a signed copy, even though it's not to me, it's to the guy I bought the book from, Jens Neergaard. Let's see if I can find the date here, the publication date. There it is, 1976 by Paul McGrill. There you have it, guys. This book, even by today's standards, are still so impressively good. It's to think about how he came up with all this knowledge, Paul McGrill, like a mad scientist, hand rolling out positions days in, days out, to acquire the amount of knowledge that he had. I think he was around 30 years old, probably even less, perhaps even less than 30 when he wrote this book. It's just impressive. When you compare it by today's standard, I would say it's probably still like 90 to 95% accurate. Of course, there's some errors here and there. He didn't have computers to assist him in rolling out positions and stuff like that. He had to do that by hand. It contains more or less all edges of backgammon. It deals with general strategy. It deals with a lot of specific strategies, specific themes, specific types of positions: prime versus prime, opening game, end game, races, all kinds of positions, back game positions. More or less covered the whole thing in this book, and there's a reason why it was considered as the backgammon bible for decades, and perhaps still is. I would rate this book, obviously the historical rating is going to be 6 out of 6, no doubt about it. I mean, there's no other book in backgammon history like this book, by far the most significant and important and legendary book ever written by a legendary player. So that's a 6 out of 6. Content wise from 2019, I think I want to give it we are in the 4.5-5 range. Let's give it a 5. Let's give it a 5, just because it's still very accurate, and he's a great writer. He encapsulates the reader very well. It's a motivational read. The drawback to this book is that it's very long. As we can see here, it's a big thick book, and there's a lot of text in it, and it takes quite a while to get through this book. Therefore, I wouldn't recommend it to a beginner. I would recommend it to a real backgammon aficionado who doesn't mind spending maybe 30, 40 hours reading a backgammon book, and you want to read it to become part of the Paul McGrill universe. It's a great legacy. It's part of backgammon history. Would I recommend it to a beginner? Probably not. There's a couple of other books that I would recommend that are much easier and faster to read, where you cover more or less the same content, and perhaps in a bit more shallow way. But if you're a backgammon aficionado, it's a must read, McGrill's Backgammon. Okay, next book up, we have Modern Backgammon from Bill Roberti. Bill Roberti, Gammon Press. I don't know if he owns this company, Gammon Press, but it seems that a lot of his books were published by this company. Bill Roberti is, I think, the most significant backgammon author, alongside with Paul McGrill. Yeah, I don't think there's any doubt about that. He's been very productive. He published several backgammon books. He's a world champion himself. I think he's still a quite strong player. I'm not really sure because I've never met him. But I think he still plays in the American Tour, and I think he's still a very, very strong player. Unlike Paul McGrill, who stopped publishing books after his first one, Bill Roberti published several, and that's great. The one book at hand, Modern Backgammon, that's definitely my favorite book from Bill Roberti. The book is a description of the new, at that time, computer neural net AI algorithm that basically solved the game of backgammon. And he was trying to explain how and why the computer plays as it does. So it's the first of its kind. I think it's, let's see if we can find the publication date here in it. I believe that it's late 90s, 2001 by Gammon Press. So the book is from 2001, and that means that he's probably had like Snowy 1 or 2, or at least Jellyfish had been out for several years. So it's the first book that really tries to explain this new efficient playing style that the computers had in contrast to the old school style, where some people played pure and priming games and often got into back games, or some played safe and racing oriented. The computer style seemed to be more efficiently minded and didn't have a bias in terms of a game plan. It kind of just went the way that the dice took you. I do have some critiques of this book. I think he didn't get it completely right. He outlines four main principles that the computer style applies. Efficiency, yes, thumbs up. The first one, I agree. That's definitely a main principle. Connectivity, yes, it's a principle. Is it a main one? Is that one of the four basic principles of the computer? I don't think so. I do believe it's a main concept and it's valuable and all, but I wouldn't rank connectivity as a top four concept. Robustness, again, yes, it's a good concept. It's kind of a mixed concept where you have the mix of flexibility and structure combined. Yeah, pretty good backgammon concept, but again, is it a top five ranking top four ranking concept? I don't know. And then the fourth one, non-commitment, which I believe is, I believe non-commitment can be explained by other concepts, basically. I think it's more of a chess thing or some other games where you have non-commitment as a concept. So, we can talk about some of those critiques a little bit later on as well. But all in all, Modern Backgammon, hugely important work. It's the book, when I read it about half a year into my own backgammon career about 15 years ago, that moved my game the most by far. I went from playing at an advanced level to become an expert overnight just by reading this book. Great position selection and really illustrated this new efficient playing style. So I believe that's the best book Roberti wrote, one of the best books on backgammon ever written. I'll rate it, in a historical point of view, I'll rate it a 6 out of 6 as well, like McGrill's backgammon, just because it was a monumental work and people still read it to this day. With regards to content, from a 2019 perspective, I would rate it 4.5 to 5. Let's give it a 5 as well. It's still very good, especially if you haven't really been introduced to some of these descriptions on modern backgammon style. Then I would say this is a really good book for you. The reason I don't give it 6 is, I do have some critiques. I kind of updated my own beliefs on backgammon and my own ways of thinking that I believe is superior to some of the ideas that Roberti had in this book. Then we have these books, also from Roberti, the Advanced Backgammon series, a two-volume series. One is called Positional Play, the other one Technical Play. These books were written in, or published, let's see. Here we have it, 1991. So we're in the early 90s here. Pre-bot era. Yeah, so the aggregate knowledge of the game were not very high at this moment. I think that Roberti was well beyond his time writing these books. They're good books, but when you read it now, I recently reread the books, I don't believe it's really good backgammon books anymore. There's too many mistakes. There are too many positions where he doesn't seem to get the essential variable in the position. So his analysis is not quite so clear. I think he's well excused because he didn't have the bots to help him. One thing that I did pick up from these books when I read it in my first year as a backgammon player was the tool where you use dice probabilities or dice combinations to estimate backgammon equities or winning chances. You know, you have a 36 dice combinations and a sequin consists of two players having 36, so that's 36 squared, 1296 dice combinations, and you can estimate winning chances using this method when you multiply combinations. So that was a great tool that I learned. I did pick that up from this book. Kind of an eye-opener thing. Ah, okay, backgammon is a probability game. Okay, it's not just about positional structure and all that. That the probabilities and the dice combinatorics actually matters a lot. With regards to historical significance, I think I'm gonna rate these books 5 out of 6. They have a lot of reference positions that people used for a long time, even though they weren't completely accurate. And with regards to current day content, I think I would rate it 2 or 3 out of 6. I don't want to rate this book too high. There's simply too many positions where he doesn't get the essence of the position. But he's well excused, as I said. The book was written in the late 80s, early 90s. Then we have a book that I unfortunately don't have with me here from Roberti called 501 Backgammon Problems. Now that's a good book. That was actually the very first backgammon book that I read, and it helped me tremendously, obviously. It was also written pre-bot era. And in that book, I read it twice. I read it as the first book ever, and then I reread it some years after when I was already a world-class player. And it struck me how accurate he was in this book. He really got a lot of position right. Maybe he did have some early programs like Jellyfish or something to assist him. Or otherwise, it's very impressive how many positions he got right in this one. I do believe that the analysis in the book are slightly shallow. It's not a book really for the expert reader. It's more of a beginner's book, I would say, but a good one. And the cool thing about this book is it's a quiz format. So you have a position, and then you come up with your own guess, and then you flop to the backside of the book, and then you see the result there and his analysis and explanations of the position. So that really got me thinking a lot. I learned about flexibility, rolls like 4-3 in the opening. You don't just play 13-6, you take two checkers down from the midpoint, so you have flexibility to improve your prime and develop your structure. I learned about the pips, why the raise matters, why an advanced anchor matter, all those things. So a pretty good book. Again, it wouldn't be my first book that I would recommend to a beginner, but it would probably be in my top three. Then he made some other books, Roberti, Backgammon for Winners and Backgammon for Serious Players, I believe they're called. And that, I don't have high regards for those books. I think they're too shallow and not really good, neither for the beginner, because there's other books much better, nor for the expert, because it's too shallow, and it seemed more like books written for non-backgammon players somehow. Even though that would be a good thing, I disregard those backgammon books as books of quality. I think he that was in the lighter end of the range that he made, and then he made some great backgammon books like Modern Backgammon, one of the best books ever written. So well done, Bill Roberti. I'm a little bit sad that you haven't published a backgammon book since 2001, Modern Backgammon, but maybe he's busy with other things. He did co-author the legendary poker books, Harrington and Hold'em, so maybe that's been keeping him busy. Okay, let's move on. Then we have a book that I don't have with me here. That's actually my favorite backgammon book of all time. The book is called Book A, 3-1 Opening. It's written by Nack Ballard and Paul Weaver, and I believe actually is the best backgammon book ever written. Yeah, it's a book that only deals with the opening rolls with 3-1 in the opening sequences. That's a whole book. How to move 3-1 in the second and third roll of the game. Yeah, but the amount of strategic principles and backgammon tactics that you get from this book is just unbelievable. From a scientific point of view, the book was so well made. They rolled out all the positions. Their explanations are just top, top, top. From a tactical point of view, like how they consider all the dice sequences and the general principles that they could derive from just studying these opening positions is incredible. I hope that we get to see the book B, 4-2 opening. But I think it's like 10 years ago since they published this book, and we haven't had book B yet. I don't know if it'll ever come. Maybe there's too much overlap of the derived principles that you get out of studying 4-2 compared to 3-1. Maybe it's more or less the same, even though it's different backgammon problems to solve. But that is a book that I will recommend. That's my favorite book. I think from a 2019 content wise, I still rate it 6 out of 6. And from a historical point of view, I guess I would have to rate it a 3, just because it's so underrated, this book. Nobody talks about this book. It should be the number one book of all the expert players in my estimation. Maybe I can give them a little boost with this video. So yeah, a 6 for the content, and let's give it a 3 just because it's so underrated and nobody really talks. I don't know how much it sold, this book. I don't know. I highly doubt that it was a bestseller, just since nobody really talks about it anymore. But what a great backgammon book that was. Okay, let's move on. Then we have what else do we have? Then we have a couple of books from Kit Woolsey. Especially I'd like to outline or highlight the orange book, New Ideas in Backgammon. I think that was a great book. That was a good book. It's written in the early stages of the bot era, kind of like Modern Backgammon. I think they had jellyfish to roll out positions. So it's a quiz book, and then they have the rollout results, and then they even had like a vote from expert players as well, next to the rollout result, and then they did their own analysis of each position, which was highly in-depth analysis. So that was a really good book as well. Definitely a more heavy book. I wouldn't recommend it to a beginner. Slightly outdated, since it was still biased from the earlier days, the old timers, but definitely the authors definitely had that first step into the new era of backgammon, which makes it a really good book. So that one I would recommend as well. I would probably give it it's a 4 or 5 content wise. Let's give it a 4.5 for content in 2019 perspective. I'm being a little bit cheap there. It could have been a 5, but let's give it a 4.5. And from a historical point of view, I'll give it a 4.5 as well, because I think it wasn't as important as modern backgammon, but it was one of those first mover books after we had the bots and trying to explain this new style of backgammon. So I'll give it a 4.5. Let's see, what else do we have? Then we have there's another good book that I really liked from Jeremy Bagai called Classical Backgammon Revisited, just because the concept is so cool. He went back to some of the most classic books of backgammon, for instance McGrill's backgammon, some other books from the 60s and the 70s, and some from Roberti's advanced backgammons as well, and found some of the positions that they got wrong, and then he rolled it out with, I think it was Snowy, and then gave some explanation for it. I must admit, it's so many years ago that since I read it that I wouldn't be able to rate it on a content wise, but I remember my impression after reading it, that was very positive. I remember that I liked the book, it was good, I learned from it, the concept is cool. So that's a book that I can recommend as well, even though it's, I think it's maybe like 12, 13 years ago since I read it, so I wouldn't be able to rate it. Then we have two books from Paul Lamford. First book was, I believe it's called Starting Out in Backgammon, or something, a beginner's book that I didn't really like. I didn't really agree with the way he explained to beginners, and it was a little bit too shallow somehow. Too shallow and not well presented. However, then he also had this book, Improve Your Backgammon, which is a short book as well. The covers of the two books look a lot alike. This book is just 120 pages, and it was published in, let's see, I would guess it's published probably in like 2004 or something. Let me see if I can see when it's, here we have it, 2002. Okay, so this book, I actually like this book a lot. It doesn't deal with general strategy, it's more specific strategy. It has a cool racing formula, some cool prime versus prime positions where he derived some rule of thumb just by looking at some, analyzing some positions and some math. So that was a good book. That's a book that I would probably rate at, let's give it a 4 in content wise. And from a historical point of view, it's not really that famous. It's a small book. Most people don't even know about it. So let's give it a 2 out of 6 in a historical perspective. Then we have these books, which are 3-volume books. It's called Cube Action 1000 from a Japanese guy called Ruichi Shina. And these books, luckily, since they're from Japan, they don't contain any analysis. All it is, position, extreme gammon rollout result. Which, if you're an expert player like me, it's kind of cool, because then you don't have to read what other people think about position. You can just see the position, analyze it yourself, see the result, and move on, and just scroll through the pages. So that's pretty cool. I like those books. It's difficult to rate it as books because it's more just a publication of a position database. So I'm not going to rate it. But I like traveling with those books when I go to a tournament. I bring them in my bag, and on the flight I sit there and scroll through the pages to recalibrate my neural net with positions. So that's pretty cool. Then we have, what else do we have? We've been through the big authors, the great authors. Yes. Then we have Michi-san from Japan. Unluckily, I don't have my copy with me right here to show you guys. He just, like last week or something, published his volume number 2 called Endgame Techniques. And the first one was called Opening Concepts. And that's a book that I really liked. It was published, I guess, not last year, but probably like 2017. So it's a very new book, recent book. And Michi obviously is one of the best players in the world. Always nice to when great grandmasters share their thinking and their perspective on the game, and this one is no exception. He brings a lot of new terminology to the game in this book. We all know now the double tiger, that's Michi. Break the mountain, unstack the midpoint, and stuff like this. He has some more that I don't remember now off the top of my head, but this way of using storytelling and metaphors into backgammon theory, it's a good way for humans to create heuristics and to remember. So that's one of the cool things about this book. He kind of breaks down the book into proverbs or rule of thumb, basically, and that's his strategic guideline in these opening positions, that he has proverbs that tells him, guides him to make the best moves, which is, it's a pretty effective strategy, especially in specific game plans like the opening game or in other defined state game plans. That's using proverbs a pretty good strategy for finding the best move. Obviously, my critique is that not all positions can you apply proverbs. Sometimes you get into complicated positions, and in those cases it might have been better to study overall game strategy rather than focusing on specific proverbs. So that if I could say one critique of that book, then it's heavily depending on the proverbs that he present, and a little bit less on general game understanding. But that's completely fine. That's what the book was. I learned a lot from that book. I rate it very highly. I think I would rate it from a content wise, I think I can't give it a 6 because it deals with a little bit of a narrow topic, but so did book A actually. Let's give it a 5.5, and could even be 6. From a content perspective, this book is awesome. It's super recommendable. One of the best books, newer books on the market. I would recommend it to anyone. It's easy to read. It's quite short. There's a lot of great points. The terminology he brings is great. So content-wise, you know what? Let's give it a 6. Let's give it a 6. I think he deserved a 6 with this book. From a historical point of view, it's still such a recent book that it's difficult to rate it. I guess the verdict is still out there. Let's see how it does over the next decade. So it's too new to rate it. I think it's one of the better selling books of the new era, and hopefully it'll be a famous book. I can't wait to read the sequel, Endgame Techniques, the second volume. I'm hopefully gonna pick up a copy next week when I go back to Nordic Open in Copenhagen, and I think I heard that they're gonna sell the book there, so I'm gonna pick up a copy and I'm gonna read it as a sponge. So what else do we have? Okay, yeah, then we have two books that obviously I don't want to rate because I wrote the book myself. So this one is Backgammon Galaxy, From Basics to Badass. I wrote this book, I think we're back in 2012. So it's not that recent anymore, but obviously in backgammon literature, it's still a quite recent book. Okay, my memory is completely off. I see here that the English version was published in 2015, which means that the Danish one was 2014. So I wrote the book in 2013, published in 2014 and 15. Okay. So Backgammon, From Basics to Badass, is more of a book that deals with all the fundamental principles of the game. It's both general in strategy, and it's also specific in strategy. Basically just break down all the concepts and principles that any beginner up to the advanced or perhaps even expert level should know of. And if he doesn't, then he'll have clear leaks in his game. It's kind of similar to McGrill's Backgammon, except that I try to make the book a lot easier to read, a lot faster, fewer pages, less text, more positions, just to boil down these essential principles into a shorter format, basically. Therefore, I would recommend my own book over McGrill's. just because you can read it in a quarter of the time, and the topics are more or less the same, actually. I'm not saying that my book is comparable to this monumental work of Paul McGreal. Obviously, that's the biggest and most legendary book ever, but it's kind of comparable, and I would probably recommend my own book over his if you're a complete beginner, just because it's a much easier read, and you're supposed to be playing, not reading, right? And then we have my second book, which is this one, Backgammon Pure Strategy, which I published in 2017. This is a completely different book. The first one, From Basics to Badass, that was a beginner's, quote-unquote beginner's book about the fundamentals. Pure Strategy is definitely not a beginner's book. It's kind of a philosophical book. I try to break down backgammon strategy into the smallest pieces as possible, and then to put it all together again to see the big picture. That's basically the idea of it. And the way that I try to do it, kind of like Roberti did with modern backgammon, therefore if I had to compare this book with another book, it would be that one. I just think that I went deeper than he did, and also I'm standing on the shoulders of other great authors like Paul McGreal and Bill Roberti, and have 15-20 years experience with in the computer era, so I can use these tools and I can play online and all that stuff. So obviously it's not, I have a big advantage in this regard. So I think I went one or two steps further than Bill Roberti did. I came up with other concepts as the most fundamental ones. I believe that the race and structure, that's basically the two most fundamental concepts. Like the backgammon is a race, and you can block your opponent if you make a point, and you can gain race if you hit. So that's, in my opinion, the most fundamental concepts you have, and then everything builds on top of that, like flexibility, connectivity, efficiency, that's a big one, efficiency, and so on, racing efficiency, all that stuff that we know, timing, that's a deep one. And some of these concepts can be broken into a smaller concept, for instance, the concept of robustness. I believe that's a combination of other concepts like structure and purity and flexibility combined. And the thing is that it, depending on the backgammon type position you have at hand, then you have to know which concepts carry more weight, which concepts to apply in this position to find the best move. So for instance, if you're in a backgammon position, you don't care about the race, it doesn't matter. Only thing that matters is timing and structure, much more important than what the pip count says it is. Sometimes you can use the pip count to have an indication of the timing, but the race in itself doesn't matter because that's not a game plan you want to follow, and so on. If you're in a holding game, it's the other way around, then the race is everything, and you want to play safe and don't leave any shots. So yeah, that's kind of what I'm exploring in this book, and I kind of base it on the so yeah, first I break down all the concepts into the deepest axiom of backgammon, and then I try to build on top of that, and then secondly I take on the proposition that all backgammon games are won in one of four different ways, and that's what I call the four main game plans. You can prime, you can blitz, you can race at home, and if all three offensive game plan doesn't work, you still have some contact where you can try to hit a shot and turn the game around. And that's basically it. All backgammon strategy boils down to one of these four game plans. And yeah, so that's kind of the framework for this book. And I also had the advantage of studying the how the neural nets worked, the AI algorithms that solve backgammon, and it turns out that it's actually quite helpful for a human being to adopt some of the methods that the AIs are using to solve backgammon. So I take inspiration on that and try to imitate how a computer thinks as a heuristic to come out with the best move, or make an evaluation of how good is this position, should I take a drop. But that definitely a heavy read. I would recommend it if you are an expert player and not if you're a beginner, unless you're a really enthusiastic beginner. Let's save that book for a couple of books in. Yes, that's it, guys. Let me know in the comments section what your top three backgammon books is. Oh, I forgot to give you mine. My top three is number one, Book A, Opening Roll 3-1 by Nag Ballad and Paul Weaver. That's my number one. My number two, Modern Backgammon, Bill Roberti. Even though I kind of dislike it now when I read it, because I feel like he's not really, there's too many positions where he doesn't get the essential feature, and I disagree with too many of his analysis and so on. So I don't really like to read it now, but the effect that it had on my game 14 years ago when I read this book was amazing. So that's still one of my favorite books. That's my number two. My number three, it's a close one, but it would have to go to Paul McGrill, Backgammon, just because it's such a pleasure to read this book. It's like you feel like you're stepping into backgammon history when you're reading it. The close fourth place, almost tied for the third place, would be Michi's opening concept. I like that book as well. So let me know what top three backgammon books you have. And let me know if there's some backgammon books that I should have talked about here. Perhaps I could have mentioned Malcolm Davis Praxis backgammon books, which are pretty good. I could have mentioned Chris Bray Backgammon for Beginners. No, what's it called? Backgammon for Dummies, which is cool because it's part of the For Dummies book series. Yeah, any other books that I'm forgetting, let me know in the comment section, and maybe the discussion can go on. And especially if I gave some bad arguments or if I came to a bad conclusion or something, let me hear your arguments and let's have a discussion. I'll always correct my opinion if I get a good argument. Okay, guys, have a good day. That's all for me for today. See you in Backgammon Galaxy.